Hello everyone, I am Theotona, research engineer at Adobe, and in this talk I'm going to present you the work my collaborators and I did on a novel tessellation-free approach to ray trace surfaces with displacement mapping. Displacement mapping is a powerful tool for adding geometric details over a base surface by applying an offset called displacement along the normal. The displacement intensity is being represented here as the grayscale images. As you can see with this rendering, the with and without displacement mapping has a great impact on the final appearance, especially regarding silhouettes and self-shadowing. In this talk, we want to ray trace surfaces with displacement on a GPU with high quality, which is a challenge due to the limited available memory. We assume the base surfaces on which the displacement is applied are triangle meshes, and we target high-resolution displacement maps, and as you can see with these close-ups, this kind of displacement content is almost worth an entire scene of geometric details. Finally, we focus on a digital content creation context, meaning that anything should be modifiable at any time, from displacement scaling to the amount of tiling applied on a surface. Methods that render surfaces with displacement can be placed into two overall categories. The first category, which is the most efficient in terms of performance, rely on an explicit surface realization, typically achieved in a preprocessed step using tessellation. But in the context of ray tracing, the geometric content must be random accessible, so tessellation leads to huge memory overhead, as both the display surface and its acceleration structure must be present in memory. Even worse, in case of tiling, the memory is linear with the number of tiles. And moreover, the tessellation discrete sampling can struggle to represent the displacement high frequency. Reducing this cost by using lazy evaluation and caching of local tessellation is still an active field of research. The second category, consider instead the display surface as an implicit surface that can be intersected using ray marching. This kind of method relies on being able to map points on the ray to points on the texture's displacement space. However, as shown on the right, the mapping from wall to texture space, shown in gray, is not simple. In a special case of height field marching, this space is flat and the mapping is trivial, so numerous methods have been proposed to remarch this type of surface efficiently. Parallax mapping and relief mapping works on a general case, but under the assumption that the texture displacement space is locally flat, thus approximating the complex mapping by a trivial one. Finally, shear mapping approaches either suffer from distortions when using a simple mapping or have to rely on nonlinear ray marching to approximate the true complex mapping. On the contrary, our method only relies on the texture to world space mapping, which is always explicit and well defined. Some of the previous methods not only consider the display surface as implicit, but also consider implicit acceleration structures for intersecting them. Heidrich and colleagues used the fine arithmetic in the context of procedural surfaces with procedural displacement. On the other hand, Smith and colleagues showed that min-max displacement bounds can be used to perform a linear traversal of implicit microprism for triangle meshes. Our method is inspired from both of these works, since we use an implicit hierarchy using a fine arithmetic and min-max bounds to perform a traversal of ephemeral bounding boxes and microprimitives. In this talk, we will first see how to compute the bounding volume of the display surface for a given region on the base surface. We will then see how to use these bounding volumes to define an implicit acceleration structure that can be traversed to compute intersection with the display surface. Finally, we will cover some practical detail of the GPU implementation and some applications. So let's see first how to effectively compute bounds of the display surface. And let's start by defining what is a display surface. For any given texture coordinate, the displaced point is obtained by combining position on the base surface, offsetted by the value of the height sampling along the base normal. From this formula, we can see that computing bounds for the displacement means that, on one hand, we need to bound the base position on normal, which purely depends on the bend geometry. On the other hand, we need to bound the height values, which purely depends on the displacement maps. And finally, we need a meaningful approach to combine both bounds. Our main idea here is to decouple the two computations, and restrict the computation to UV domains corresponding to text cells. Focusing first on the displacement, we rely on pre-computed bounds using a so-called min-max mipmap. The idea is simple. For each mipmap text cell, We have to pre-compute a single min-max bound. Its computation is pretty straightforward. Given a height sampling, we first rely on closed form formula to compute bounds for the finest MIP level. The remaining levels are simply obtained using a classical MIP mapping, only replacing the averaging kernel by a min-max operation. However, as we want to support level of details, our min-max MIP map must also provide bounds for the pre-filtered version of the displacement. Looking here at four displacement values of a given MIP level, we can see that the MIP map min-max is indeed a conservative estimate of the interpolated height. However, if we now consider the pre-filtered version of the min-max MIP map, it is no longer a conservative estimate for the pre-filtered height interpolation. So, with a special adjustment that we detail in a paper, the min-max MIP map can fully estimate all pre-filtered version of the displacement and can be made suitable for level of detail rendering. Going back to the base surface, we will now focus on a single displaced base triangle. The reason for that is that both the position and normals have simple closed form formula, as they are typically just interpolated between the three vertices of the base triangle. Since these computations are arithmetic in nature, we will use the fine arithmetic as a tool for both computing the bounds and combining the bounds. So in affine arithmetics, quantities, instead of being just scalar or vectors, are instead a linear combination of symbolic variables which can only take values between minus 1 and 1. More formally, these affine forms represent Minkowski sums of line segments in a vector space. So to give a more visual example, in two dimensions, let's look at the different terms of the above formula. Our first term is only a 2D constant vector, so the affine form is just a single point in 2D. The next term adds a segment with direction and scale, so the affine form is now a segment. The next term adds again another segment, and our affine form now represents a parallelogram in 2D. And with the final term, the affine form now represents this non-trivial region in 2D. Going back to our text cells, we can directly convert a text cell as a 2D affine form, using the text cell center and its two half axes. With the displacement bounds obtained from the min-max MIP map, we can now plug them both into the displacement formula, but using a fine arithmetic. This gives us a 3D affine form that can be easily converted to an axial-line bounding box. A fine arithmetic is compatible with all the arithmetic operators needed for the displaced surface, so addition, multiplication, dot product, and inverse square root. We could ask ourselves the question of why using this complex arithmetic instead of, for example, a simpler interval arithmetic. And the reason for that is that our quantities have some correlation, and taking this correlation into account leads to tighter bounds. So looking at this example of a base surface and its corresponding normal cone, with their respective bounds being represented as colored box. If you combine these bounds using interval arithmetic, we basically translate the blue box over every possible green box location, which leads to a not-so-tight bounding region. But in this situation, if we go from left to right on the base surface, the normal points from right to left. So if we combine the two using a fine arithmetic, some constellation happens, and we have much tighter bounds than using interval arithmetics. So now that we have a process to compute bounds for UV domain, let's see how to use these bounding volumes to build an acceleration structures. Now that we have a process to compute bounds for UV domain, let's see how to use these bounding volumes for accelerating the intersection routine. The core idea is that a MIP map implicitly defines a hierarchy on a texture space, where each text cell is connected to its four subtext cells. On a side note, this hierarchy also extends beyond the unisquare, which is useful to handle arbitrary tiling. With our text cell to 3D box procedure, the 2D hierarchy actually implicitly defines a 3D hierarchy over the display surface, where as we go down into the MIP levels, boxes are being tighter. We call this hierarchy the displacement BVH, or DBVH for short. So let's see how to use this DBVH to compute an intersection with a ray. Our traversal in texture space starts at the root, which is typically the smallest texel that contains our base triangle in UV space. Here, our ray intersects the 3D box associated to the root, so we go down in the hierarchy and consider the four subtexels of the root. Here, the ray does not intersect the 3D box, so instead of going down, we simply go to the next texel. Again, here there is an intersection, so we go down and continue traversing texels. Here we have an intersection, but since we are at the finest level, we reached a leaf, so the actual intersection logic performed in leaves will be described right after. Now that we have traversed the four subtexels, we go up and continue traversing. And again, now that we also reach the four subtexels, we go up to the end node, concluding the traversal. Level of detail with this kind of hierarchy is simply achieved by skipping texel below the target MIP level. We give more detail on the paper on how to optimize this traversal, for example using texel discards. The previous traversal gives access to the relevant texel that might produce an intersection. So we propose a range of local intersectors with different quality suite trade-offs. The fastest ones are the closed form intersections, obtained for example by simply considering the leaf boxes, or by doing a local tessellation, by example generating two triangles per texel. Also, since at that scale our UV domain is between four texel centers, we can also consider continuous height sampling, such as binary or bicubic height filtering. Unfortunately, the intersection in that case can only be found using an iterative solver, such as Newton method. Let's now discuss the GPU implementation that we implemented using the Vulkan ray tracing extensions, which provide several programmable shaders here displayed in color boxes. However, this requires to provide a bottom-level acceleration structure, or BLAS for short, for each intersectable geometry. So we represent our display surfaces as custom geometry, where each display primitive is represented as an axial-aligned bounding box and an intersection program, which is just our MIPMAP traversal plus the local intersection mode. One nice outcome of this pipeline is that the intersection logic is decoupled from the shading logic, typically happening in the closest or mid shaders, meaning that our method is compatible in theory with any shading model. Let's take a look at what the BLAS and traversal boxes look in practice. Here is a final render of a display surface on the right, with a zoom out on the left that will serve as a reference. The BLAS boxes, shown here, are axis-aligned bounding boxes in object space, and each box represents bounds associated to one single displaced base triangle. These boxes need to be stored in memory. On the contrary, the traversal boxes are axis-aligned boxes in a local triangle space. They are ephemeral and generated on a per-ray basis. They represent the bound associated to a single texel at multiple MIP levels. This table shows that each data structure needed to ray trace or display surfaces can be cheaply created or updated. The cost in both time and space is at worst linear in terms of the number of displacement pixels and linear in the number of base primitives. This motivates the usage of our method in a digital content creation context. Here are some past trace results, shown on the right with the amount of memory used to represent the geometry. The base surface is shown at the top left, and the displacement map is shown at the bottom right. And you can see the amount of details produced by the displacement. We show here a geomorph level of detail, which can be used for zoom outs of objects without popping artifacts. Our approach is also robust enough to support advanced ray tracing effects, such as subsurface scattering or translucency, as shown here with the same DBVH and the same base mesh, but using different materials. We compare our method with relief mapping. We see on the right that we did not suffer from discretization artifacts, shown here, or leakage of lights through the surface that can happen with relief mapping. We also compared our method with adaptive tessellation with an equal memory budget, here 35 megabytes. Our method is able to represent the full geometry complexity stored in the displacement map, while adaptive tessellation struggles to represent high frequencies with high fidelity. We show here result with an interactive modification of the displacement within a GPU path tracer. For example, modifying the displacement scaling only triggers a blast recomputation, which is pretty cheap. We show also here that we are able to modify the amount of tiling with no memory overhead and quite cheaply as well. Also, by decoupling shading from intersection logic, we can completely modify the material parameters easily. Our method does suffer from limitation, the main being the ray tracing performances, typically being 1 to 2 orders of magnitude slower than ray tracing pure triangle meshes. Some direction of research that could lead to improved performance would be to devise a better traversal order in a MIP map that would give guarantees so that any intersection would allow an early return. Also, a more efficient routine for early texel discards could also give huge performance improvements. One other limitation is the domain of application of our method, as it is currently restricted to scalar displacement and triangle meshes. While extending our work to vector displacement may be achieved by using a 3D displacement min-max MIP map, supporting subdivision surfaces will require explicit affine algorithmic formulas to compute bounds, which is not trivial. In conclusion, we propose the method for high-quality ray tracing of surfaces with displacement that supports level of detail and a range of local intersectors. The method is based on an actuation structure, which is simply a texture and is displacement-centric. It has a low memory footprint and is suitable for real-time editing and is fully tiling compatible. So thank you for your time, and I will be happy to answer questions about your work.